First, I will start with some introductory remarks. So basically, if you will have some questions, don't hesitate to interrupt me and ask your questions. And second of all, this is a topic which, in my view, doesn't have right answers or just only one answer. I will provide you some maybe advice or answers which worked with me, or answers which I agree with, or answers at least which I don't disagree with, right? So, but if you have a different view, just tell it, it's not a problem. Yes, so this is the outline of my presentation. I think I was introduced already quite nicely, so the first point I will just go through very briefly. So, but why I want to introduce myself is, it's not actually to promote myself, but just to show you my experience with publications. And at the end of this point, you should conclude that I'm somewhere in the, you know, basically average type of person, right? At least in my view. Then the second point is to discuss what are the high impact journals and publications. As you will see, there are many views on these, and it's a very controversial topic. And I think it's very important to know these details, because currently we are judged and evaluated based on these measures. And I think we should be aware of problems which are related or connected with these measures. This will be just very brief. Why to target? And now I change from this point on, I will change from talking about high impact journals to talking about decent journals and publications, because I like this term much more. Even, of course, I know that European Commission uses this term a lot, high impact, but for some reasons I like better talking about decent journals and decent publications. And the main part of this session will be point four, which is a list of various small advices on how to prepare a paper for a decent journal. Basically, we will go through the whole process from starting and developing the idea till the end, which is some kind of communication activities and promotion of your publications. And then quick summary, just the main points from the whole presentation. So some details about me. So I studied at this university. I did my PhD studies at this university. And after my PhDs, I continued as an assistant professor. Then I was lucky enough that I received an offer to move to Dresden, and I joined there a group of Professor Dirk Helbing, and this was for me really a big change, and it helped me really to progress with my scientific career. And then together with a group of Professor Helbing, after some time, we moved to ETH Zurich. So basically, I spent with this professor 5 years, and he's, I still consider him like my main mentor in the science. And we'll talk about that, but I think it's important to have some people who you consider that are your mentors, basically people who you follow in science. You may see that I was located at quite diverse places. So here I'm part of the Faculty of Management, Science and Informatics. And basically by background, I'm programmer. Then I moved to Faculty of Transportation and Traffic Sciences for a while. Then we moved and we changed from transport to the Department of Humanities, Social and Political Sciences, but still we remained very quantitative and computational. And the name of our chair was Chair of Sociology, in particular of Modeling and Simulation. Nowadays, the name is Chair of Computational Social Science. And then I was very curious to have an experience of of really very different environment. So I had an opportunity to become a part for a while of the Faculty of Physics, and this was Department of Fundamental Physics in Spain. And now currently I'm part of the ERAdiate team, and also I'm an associate professor of applied informatics at the Faculty of Management Science. So what are subject areas, or in what areas I do my research? These are the key topics which, in my view, characterize this the best, which is applied informatics, operations research, complex systems, and more recently, applied data science. Of course, you need some tools, you need some methods to work with, and this is, for me, mathematical modeling, optimization algorithms, computer simulations, and more recently, I'm very interested in statistical inference. And apart from having home, your scientific area, having the tools that you are using, you also need some applications where you are going to apply all of this. And during the years, I was mainly working in the area of public service systems, spreading processes, so this was a studying of dynamics on the network, critical infrastructures, these were simulations of infrastructural systems like power grid or communication networks. I did some work on transportation networks. Currently, I'm more on the electric mobility, and long, long time ago, it was also simulations of pedestrians. I guess that you are all familiar with Scopus and Web of Science. Are you familiar? Right, these are tools where you can go and you can check for the scientific performance of scientists. Right, so here I put some of my statistics. So, but basically it's what Yannick already said. Dependent on where you look, it's about 1,000 citations and maybe 30, 34, maybe 40, depends on the source, documents. And in my view, it's not only important to collect publications and to collect citations, right? This is very good for academical performance, but we should also, and I'm in basic research, but I still think that we should also think about communicating what we do to the public, to the general public. So for that, what you can hope to achieve is to get some or to collect some response on your work from the media. And we will come also to that, how to do and what to do that you improve or increase your chances with this. What can we do? Yeah, thank you. And as I was saying, I consider myself as some kind of average researcher. And it always depends to who you compare yourself, right? So these are a couple of professors I was lucky to collaborate with, and I was lucky to write some papers together with them. As I was saying, my main mentor was Professor Dirk Helping. He's currently a professor of sociology at ETH in Zurich. If you look at his performance, this is a completely different story. Of course, he has a big team and everything, but he's also a really very good scientist. So 280 documents, like almost 25,000 citations. If you look at the number of citations every year, it's 2,500, right? I haven't reached 2,500 over all my career. So this guy is getting this in one year. Another professor I was lucky to work with is Professor Albert Diaz Guilera from the University of Barcelona. He does his research in interdisciplinary physics, and here you may see basic statistics about his performance. 100 documents, 7,500 citations, 8 index 32. Another professor, Professor Frankelli, right, 67 documents, 8,000 citations, 8 index 27. So all very impressive. By this, I want to demonstrate that basically, if you want to be good, you need to learn from good people. Right. You need to be in contact with good people, and maybe if I should reduce my whole presentation just to one word, this word would be basically experience, right? You need to work with people who have the proper experience. And we can also use this slide to demonstrate something else. If you look at these people, they do the research in the different areas, right? Applied mathematics, physics, transport, and sociology. And you may see that also they perform very differently. But I would never say, for example, that Frankelli is a worse researcher than Dirk Helbing. Because the statistics reduce the life of these people too much, right? For example, you don't know that Professor Frankelli was serving in the last 10 years as a master of Christ College at the Cambridge University. And Christ College is one of the oldest colleges at the University of Cambridge. And for example, the previous master, or one of the previous masters, was Charles Darwin, right? Really big figures were taking the same position as this guy. So I really cannot say, just based on these statistics, that this guy is low profile compared to other people. Okay. So let's start discussing the topic, what are high-impact journals and what are high-impact publications? Let's hide it. So, what is your guess? When all these things started, I mean the publication in journals, of course it was not there from the very beginning, but it started at some point. So, when did the publication enterprise start? Any guess? And when the peer review started? Okay, here is the answer. It started in 1665. This was the year when the first scientific journal was created, and when the peer review process has started. So basically, already at that time, people came with the idea that scientific ideas should be judged by other scientists and published when at least a couple of people is happy with the proposed result. By the way, this journal still exists. Now it has two versions. It's Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society A and B. And it's not easy to publish there, because actually you even cannot submit a paper to this journal directly. You need to apply for being an editor of the special issue, and you need to be invited by the editor if you want to publish something there. And they are British, so they are very traditional. And they even sometimes keep this tradition that if you want to publish in this journal, you have to come to the Royal Society meeting and present your stuff. And if they say it's okay, then you can publish there. And also what this figure is showing is how the number of journals was evolving in time. Basically, this is a log normal scale, right? Here is the time, normal scale. Here is the number of journals, log scale. If you see the straight line, it shows exponential growth with a rate of about 3.5%. And this more or less also mirrors how the number of scientists was growing in time, at least up to the year 2003. What happened after we don't have here. But I would say that after probably the number of journals increased even more. So what are the high impact journals and why we measure these high impact journals the way how we measure them? This, I think, is rooted in the way how the science is working. And this is quite well illustrated by this quote from Carl Sagan. I don't know whether you know about Carl Sagan. Okay, he passed quite a long time ago, but he was quite an influential person. He was physicist and popularizer of science. And maybe you know about these space probes, Voyager 1 and Voyager 2. And you may know that they carry golden disks with recordings of human languages and some music. And he was, for example, editor of this disc, so it was up to him to decide which languages, which music to include on this disc. So he was quite an important guy at that time. And what he said about the science is that science is a very collaborative enterprise spanning from generations. When it permits us to see the far side of some new horizon, we remember those who prepared the way, seeing also for them. So how to interpret this? So basically, what is happening in science is that if someone comes with something new, writes the paper and publishes the paper, in fact, this is not so new as it may look like. Very often, if you go into details, you will realize that this novelty is maybe not so big as you could imagine because people built on the work of previous scientists. Right, and now the idea behind this qualitative view to evaluate the science is basically to measure somehow how much your work is inspiring other scientists and how much your work is used by other scientists. And this is what we are trying to measure by the indicators which are used to measure the science. And according to this, if you write a paper which no one reads and no one uses or cites, it could be seen as worthless. I don't completely agree with this, because if you are young, right, you cannot just simply start by writing very excellent papers, impressing the whole scientific community, right? This is unrealistic. So for sure, for training purposes, it's good to write basically, I would say, any type of paper. At least from the beginning. And then your ambition should be to improve and proceed. There is even the whole scientific discipline, which is focused on evaluating and measuring the science. This is not very new. This, I don't know, it has at least 50 years of history. It's called scientometrics. More recently, I was also hearing quite often the name science of science. And it's a study of science, technology, and innovation from quantitative perspective, so basically to provide measures of impacts of papers, journals, institutes, and understanding of scientific citations and maps, and this area maps the scientific fields. And it's used for policy and management, right? Basically to decide who should get funding, who should get a job, right? Okay, so now I will talk about main metrics, but I will reduce it to just very simple metrics. So we have three types of metrics to measure the scientific performance. Some of them are focusing on scholars, so on individual researchers. Some of them measure performance of papers, and some of them are focused on journals. So here are a couple of examples, like just very simple number of papers published. This can be used to evaluate researchers, this can be used to evaluate journals, or a number of downloads. Right nowadays, most of the journals even don't get really printed, right? Everything is nowadays online so you can measure how many times the paper was downloaded or how many times you can count the number of unique IP addresses from which the paper was downloaded. And this is a proxy measure for the level of outreach of the paper, right? How many people were interested in the paper. Another measure, number of citations. This can be used to judge papers and scholars. I hope you know what are citations. Okay. There are also many more modern measures, and usually if you go to some journals, they are hidden under the name altmetrics, right? And this typically includes number of citations collected from many sources, and it also includes response to the paper in media, social media, maybe from Twitter or from the reference manager Mendeley, right, where people at this place people can collect the references and then they can use them efficiently in the paper. So basically this gives you an idea whether someone at least thought about citing your paper. Okay, these are simple measures, and then the most often or most frequently used measures, and I will mention just two measures. One of them is the H index. This measure was proposed by George Hirsch in 2005, and it was and his proposal for this measure was published in the journal which is called PNAS, Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences. Do you know this journal? Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences. It's not very good sign that you don't know this journal, in my view. because it's one of the most prominent journals. And it's, okay, I will discuss this journal maybe a little bit later. Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences. Right? It's published by the National Academy of Sciences of United States. And it's not like our Academy of Sciences, so basically it's not like a research institution, but it's more like organization of the top scientists in the USA. And they are also publishing their journals, and this is the flagship journal of the National Academy of Sciences. And if something is published in this type of journal, typically it has an impact. You can see, right, Hirsch published his idea of H-index in Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences. Nowadays, all of us already heard about it, right? This is one way how to get an impact. What is the H-index? H-index is a number, just a simple number, a scalar. And the idea is to combine in this one number two things. One is the scientific productivity, so basically number of papers that you have published, and the other thing is the number of citations that you received to your papers. So this H index takes high value if you have both. And mathematically speaking, is the largest number such that H articles by a given author have at least H citations each. So here we have also a simple example. Imagine that you have four publications, and the first publication has 10 citations, second 8, 5, and the last one 3 citations. So what is your H index? It's written there. It's 3. Why it's not 4? Because there is only 3 citations that have there is only 3 papers that have at least 3 citations. There is no 4 papers that have at least 4 citations. This last one doesn't have 4 citations. You can even represent it very nicely graphically if you like more graphical representations. So basically what you need to do, you need to take all your papers, you sort them in a descending order according to the number of citations, then you draw the line under the 45 degrees, and at the point when this line crosses this curve that describes your publication, this is your H index. This has been also extended to journals. For example, Google is using H index 5. So what does it mean? In this case, what is calculated is the large, what we calculate is the number, which is the largest number H such that H articles published in previously Y years have at least H citations. So basically the same idea, just you look at papers in the previous Y years. And typically Y is 5. At least this is the number which is used by Google. So here you can see the ranking of journals by H5 index. To me, this ranking actually makes a lot of sense. So what you find at the top is a Nature. Then you have various journals from the main scientific disciplines. How do you recognize main scientific disciplines? These are the disciplines where the Nobel Prizes are awarded, right? We still follow basically this model, right? You find here journals mainly from medicine, right? From chemistry, from physics. And what you find there also is some kind of generic journals which publish research from all areas, at least they claim that, like Nature, Science, Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, the journal that I was just previously mentioning. Right, in physics, we have here Physical Review Letters, maybe Nature Communications. So, I must say that to my, you know, when I compare this list to my, or to the way how I feel about the ranking, it actually matches quite well. The other and quite often used measure for scientific impact and for mainly for in the context of journals is called impact factor. This measure was proposed by Eugene Garfield. This is a guy who is, I think he's probably one of the, if you want to blame someone for for having science so quantitative, I think he's probably one of the most responsible guys. He contributed a lot to the creation of Web of Science, to the current contents database, and so on. And in 1955, he also proposed the impact factor. And again, he published impact factor in Science. So if you remember from the previous slide, it was listed also there. What is impact factor? Impact factor is just a very simple ratio. You divide two numbers. So what you take here is the total number of times the articles were cited during the last k years. So again, there is a parameter k. So basically, how many years you are looking backwards. And for a given journal, you look at all papers published in the journal and you count all citations for papers in a given journal for a given number of years, and you divide it by the number of papers published in that journal. Typically, K is 2 or 5. Nowadays, you find it almost with every journal. Every journal is nowadays advertising its impact factor. And it's also very important here in the Slovak environment. I don't know whether you are familiar with the criteria that are used for distributing the money or for promotion of scientists in various scientific fields. It's very much driven by the impact factor. So when you look at the list of journals ranked by the impact factor, in my view, it looks, not maybe very different, but it is different, right? We do not see at the top position journals like Nature, Science. They appear, and if you would look for Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences, you would actually look for a very long time, because their impact factor is, I think, around 10 or maybe 15. So, and these are the values that you can see with these journals, which are top journals according to the impact factor. So why is that? Right? The formula for computing or for calculating impact factor is very simple. Basically, you divide by the number of publications in a given journal. And basically, every journal has the possibility to set up its own policy how many papers they are going to publish. So each journal has actually a lot to say about its impact factor. Right? Each journal can control the impact factor in a quite large range. So if you look, for example, at this top journal, which has incredible impact factor 244, it's in medicine. And if you look at number of papers they publish, of course, they reduce the number of publications a lot. It's around 25 papers. So they're very selective. And because they are very, very selective, they reach very high impact factor. So one problem which I see with this impact factor is that basically it very much depends on the policy of the journal. Each journal has a quite long range where it can control for its impact factor. And now we are coming to these problems. So we already pointed out this problem with the impact factor. It's not only that journals can control impact factors, but there are many things which are very hard to measure, right? And we should have it in the mind. And I think this is very nicely illustrated by this quote, which is usually attributed to Albert Einstein. Not everything that can be counted counts, and not everything that counts can be counted, right? So in principle, there are many things which are related to publications, and they are very hard to evaluate. Like, for example, paper may receive citations in the negative context, right? Someone makes a big mistake, but manages to publish it, and now there will be a crowd of scientists writing papers about this mistake, right? Is it really something we should value or not? I mean, this first paper, right? I don't know. There are many types of papers. One of them is review papers, right? Papers that summarize state of the art in a given area. These are even not research papers, right? And they typically receive a lot of citations. Why? Because when you write a paper, I think you already discussed it previously, that you are also supposed to at some point describe the state in a given area of research, and it's very comfortable to use for that review papers, and people often do that. So these papers are getting very often cited. So if you want a lot of citations, write review papers, maybe. Then there are another type of paper is so-called letters or short communications, dependent on the journals. The idea is basically to facilitate the speed of the spreading of the knowledge, and there are specific journals that they will tell you have to write a just very short paper because the idea should be communicated very efficiently, and we will spread it very quickly. These are also types of papers which typically attract a lot of citations because people like to read short papers with condensed information. Right? It saves time. Then, big problem, there are very big differences between scientific fields. Right? You could even see it on the example of these three guys that I was showing to you. There are fields where the number of citations, and I think for good reasons, is very small, like, for example, mathematics, applied mathematics, because this is small field, and they have a different culture in citing other papers, right? And then there are fields where the number of citations is very high, like medicine, typically, right? And the journals in medicine, they have very high impact factors. So there are big differences between scientific fields. And the second problem with, and this is, I think, also a big problem of impact factor is that basically very often I was telling you that there are indicators for scientists, journals, and publications, right? And very often what is used is the indicator which is to assess the journal is used to assess scientists. Like, for example, impact factor, right, very often. So, for example, at this university, if you want to get a special bonus for publishing a paper in a decent journal, it has to be listed in the current contents database, right? So it's a property of the journal that the journal is listed in the database. Not your, of course, also your paper, but your paper is listed because the journal is listed and not other way around, right? But you are judged. You are judged based on the journal. So, and we could go on and go on with these problems. And at some point, even Eugene Garfield himself, he admitted some possible problems with his proposal. And this is a quote from him. In 1955, it didn't occur to me that the impact would one day become so controversial. So like nuclear energy, the impact factor is mixed blessing. In the wrong hands, it might be abused, right? So we have to be very careful, and we have to watch the system, whether it's already happening or not, right? We never know when this will reach the critical value. Yes. So, and then if you are in the organization which is focusing too much on quantitative indicators, this may lead to unwished behavior, like, for example, what may happen is that quantity is, for example, preferred over quality. Right? If you are also subjected to some evaluation criteria as a PhD student, you collect some points, and there is a certain number of points for each type of publication. And now maybe sometimes it's easier to go for three easy papers than one hard paper. Right? And then we observe unethical behavior in science, like various citation cartels, various interest groups, artificially increasing impact factors of journals, and so on. So I would say quantitative view is a currently dominant view, but I hope that I convinced you that it might be also a very dangerous view at some point. What I like much more and what I like much better, but of course this is also much more fuzzy, is a qualitative view. And for example, when I worked with Professor Helbing, we were never like discussing you know, age indexes, impact factors. He had very clear view what is the map of journals. And he was always telling us, guys, at the top there is Nature, Science, and Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences. I should mention that we have like two types of journals. One type is a general and multidisciplinary science journals, and Nature, Science, and PNAS, these are general and multidisciplinary science journals. And these are the most prestigious, right? The higher is the journal, the more prestige it is, the more prestigious it is. And here on the side, I also put some examples of general and multidisciplinary science journals, which are, let's say, not so prestigious, but still quite good. All the journals that I listed here are journals that have impact factor, that are indexed in the current context database, and so on. And also, when you look at the impact factor and when you define the criteria just based on the impact factor, typically you put basically all the journals just into one big bag, right? And Even if you look at the second group of journals, which are the journals focused on a specific scientific field, I would say not all journals are the same. And we should distinguish at least a little bit between them. So there are journals which are field-specific top journals, right? Typically, if you publish there, people in a given area will notice, right, and will see it. Then there are, I would say, such a good mid journals when it comes to prestige, like other field-specific journals. And then at the bottom, there are low-profile field-specific journals. And this gives us some kind of hierarchy. Of course, as PhD students, you shouldn't start going for these guys here. It's, I think, not very realistic. But maybe you should operate somewhere here in this area, and as you proceed, as your career continues, I think it's better than focusing on quantity is basically to focus on climbing this hill, which I put here, right, this Mount Everest, and to try to get as high as you can. So that's why I don't like to talk about high impact journals, but I like much better this term, decent journals. And I think it's basically a role of your institution and a role of your advisor to give you this map, to explain you this map and tell you which part of this map you should address. This landscape of journals, it creates some kind of space. You can even imagine it like Euclidean space, if you like. And you can move in this landscape across various dimensions. And dependent where you position yourself, you get or you may expect a different type of audience for your paper. So when we look at the general and multidisciplinary science journals, here the main dimension along which we can move is the prestige of the journal, right? While having the most prestigious journals here and let's say less prestigious here on the right hand side. When you look at the journals in a specific scientific field, then you can move at least along these two main dimensions. One of them is a specialization of the journal. So what does it mean? Imagine that you did nice invention which has to do something with lasers. You improved laser, I don't know, I'm not expert on lasers, but you improved laser in one way or another. And what you can do, how you can try to publish. Of course, there is a specific journal about lasers. So, for example, you can go for laser physics letters. But lasers, this is a part of optics, right? It's a subfield inside optics. So maybe you can consider optics letters. But optics is a part of physics. So maybe you can consider physical review letters. But physics is a part of science. So then you can consider maybe science, right? And dependent on when and how you move along this, you can expect that the audience and the readership of your paper will be different. Right here, this will be really geeks on lasers and maybe not paying attention or at least not too much attention to something else. Right here, it's the whole physics community. Here, it's the whole scientific community. Then another possible dimension which you should consider when you are looking or when you are selecting a journal is, at least this is true for me, I don't know, maybe it cannot be generalized to other fields, But it's some kind of trade-off between theory and applications. So how much in your paper you are going to focus on the theory and how much you are going to focus on applications. So let's take an example. So imagine that you wrote a paper about very nice algorithm for charging electric vehicles. And what you can do? Well, basically, maybe you can study properties of this algorithm. You can formulate proof theorems, and you can prove these theorems. Right? It's very theoretical. So then you go for very theoretical journal, like Science Journal on Discrete Mathematics. But if you want to, or if you want to produce something more applied, then maybe the idea could be that electric mobility is a part of transportation. It's a sort of transport system. And you can basically write a paper about your algorithm. You will come up with very nice and convincing case study showing that this algorithm can be really applied in the in reality, and you can think of some kind of journal in transportation, right? So, and it's still the same, maybe it's still the same methodology. It very much depends how you present it and where you focus your research. Time is really flying. I need to speed up. Here I have an example of one journal which I have experience with, and later on I will be using this journal to give you some examples. So this is a journal which is called Physical Review Letters. It's a flagship journal of the American Physical Society. And as I was saying, I think this journal is considered to be as a quite decent journal. Why? First of all, it has a very long tradition. Right? Its tradition goes back to 18th century. Of course, later, as the number of papers was growing, they also branched and they created more journals. But still, Physical Review Letters remained the flagship journal of the American Physical Society. Impact factor around 8.5, so still quite good. Acceptance rate 20%. Annual number of papers published 2,500. So what I want to demonstrate here, it's not only impact factor that decides that this journal is good, but it's also long tradition. And not only that, very often you can find also some other reasons. For example, with PRL, quite important reason why this journal is important is that many articles published in PRL were recognized for Nobel Prize in Physics and Chemistry. If you look at this, for example, in 2016, four papers were cited by the committee in the reports, right? So committee quite often decides based on papers published in this journal who will receive the Nobel Prize. So it really increases the profile of the journal, right? Okay, so I will be using this later as an example. And my last comment on this issue of high impact publications is that actually it's not only academic criteria that we should look at when we judge whether the paper is good or bad, but there are also different types of documents and publications, which are also very important, like, for example, various types of guidelines, which are publications which have large impact on practice, right? Strategic documents, recommendations, even data set. If you publish a very good data set, you can make a lot of good for science and for scientific community. Then software tools, libraries, opinion articles, commentaries, essays, right? So articles where basically people explain and reflect on what is happening and what they believe will be important in the future. And even popularization articles and books, right? Okay, so I would say that this is a sort of non-academic view on the importance of publications. So basically, in summary, when it comes to this discussion on what are important publications, we have this quantitative view, right? Hard measures, measuring. We have maybe qualitative view, And we have even non-academic types of publications, which are also very important. Just a couple of remarks. Why to target decent journals? Why to publish good publications? There are basically two sources of motivation. One is a motivation that is provided by the system, right? By the academic system. Like, it's good to boost your professional career. If you publish a lot, you will become professor quickly. You will get your PhD degree, and so on. To gain recognition in the scientific community, to help your institution, because institution is paid based on the publication performance, to accomplish and attract research projects. So if you want to get a research project, you need to publish, and very often you promise that you will publish when you are proposing your research project. So all this is creating also a lot of pressure, and you probably heard about this phrase, publish or perish, which I think summarizes all these types of motivations quite nicely, right? So this guy, he didn't publish, so he has to perish. I personally believe that this might be too little if you really want to go for what I mean by decent publications and decent journals. And I think you need some kind of internal motivation, which is just your motivation, right? No one actually has to know about it, what it is, but I think you should have something. So it could be big things like to leave a trace, or at least small trace, in the history of mankind, because the journal papers, this is a durable output, right? It's very likely that this will not disappear so quickly, this paper. Maybe you are humanist and maybe you want to contribute to the society. Maybe you want to gain some personal satisfaction because you are doing something what is really challenging, right? And so you basically, in my view, you should find something for yourself. Maybe it's really entertaining, maybe you are really enjoying the environment, I don't know. Actually, it doesn't matter what it is. It's, in my view, it's important just to you. It's not important to your readers, maybe not important to your colleagues, but you should have something. Why? Because publishing in decent journals is very hard work. You have to be very good in many things, and you have to be very patient. Sometimes it takes a really long time. And you should avoid the situation that you start something and you don't finish it. Right, you need something that will keep you to continue, right? Okay, so this was also a point that I wanted to make. And now we can move to the last part, which is a list of various types of recommendations. So if you want to publish paper in a decent journal, this paper has to have exceptional quality. And I know that there were previous talks where you already discussed many aspects of this. It should have these three components, very good content. So it should maybe provide a completely new direction, right? The novelty, significance of the paper should be high. It should have a style, right? It should be written very well. It should be maybe written in a very simple way at the same time, which is also very hard. It should contain very good graphics, right? Very nice plots, and so on. And also, nowadays, in my view, we live in the age of marketing, right? If you don't do marketing, even if you do good work, you might be lost in the group of many people who do good work, right? You should also do some communication and some publicity activities to highlight, to promote, to advertise your work. Now we will go through various steps. So now imagine that you are starting to write a decent paper. So what what is, I think, very important to consider at the very beginning is scientific collaborations. And I was telling you that what was also very important for me is that I could share experience with people who were really experienced, because in my view, you have just basically two strategies how to publish a paper in a good journal. You can either collaborate, if you don't have experience in publishing, you can either collaborate with people who have experience and will help you to do that, or you can do a trial and error. Basically, you do something, you submit, it will go back very likely, you change, submit, and so on. Right? And in my view, collaborations, this is a more efficient way. It has a lot of advantages. I summarize some of them here, and I think I don't need to really go through this. And there are also many opportunities how to search for collaborations. There are mobility programs, which you should certainly use. By the way how I got to know with Professor Helbing was that I went to his group through the Erasmus program. Right, so mobility programs are very important. Cost projects, there are various types of bilateral projects. I'm also putting into my national project some costs for short visits, right, to maintain collaboration. Visits are important. Conferences, maybe. Actually, I don't find conferences as a very good tool because it's typically too many people, and really to focus on someone and discuss with someone is very hard at such place. What also helps a lot is to find someone who could introduce you to the person you are interested to collaborate with. Okay, so the first point, I think, is collaborations. Then, you are mainly PhD students, so probably you don't need to worry about this second point too much. But maybe later you will need to worry. It's a selection of the problem you are going to work on, right? And it's something what you should consider very carefully. Once, when you reach the stage of the career, when you will have the possibility to decide for yourself what to do. But actually, I believe that even if you are a PhD student, you can direct your advisor quite a lot. Of course, everyone will hear or listen to your good suggestions. So even in your position, I think you can have a say in on what problem to you should be working. So, of course, it's good if you go for important problems, which are important for either society, because you want to do something good for society, or maybe scientific community, if you want to get some rewards from the scientific community. Another thing to consider is what type of research you are going to do. Is it going to be a research on something or research for something? Like, for example, business schools often do research on firms. So are you going to do research on firms or for firms? Right? This may actually, this point, if you think about this point, maybe you will do the same research, but what can be different is how you articulate your research. Right? For sure, it's better to articulate it in a way that it's research done for firms than on firms. Did you get the point? Basically, the point is right. When you do research for firms, that means you want to really help to firms, right? You want to you want to help them to earn more money, for example, improve something in firms. When you do research on firms, you take the data from firms, you analyze the data. And you publish results,
you
right?
Improve some system.
Of course. Uh-huh. Right, but you can also present these results in two different ways. One is on, and the other is for. And this should be done very carefully, and you should spend a lot of time on this. And there are various tools that can help you. like our various activities that can help you. You can, for example, monitor, or you should anyway, monitor what's going on in the research. And there are tools and techniques how to do it. One of them is to follow top journals for articles that are related to your research field, maybe journal like Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences. Another problem you have to solve when you are going to publish a paper is to select journal in which to publish. And here you notice that I'm actually deciding on this problem before I do the research. Right? Maybe it looks a little bit strange, but I believe that you should start thinking about the journal before you do the research. Because you should tailor the research to a given journal, right? This gives you a better chances that you can succeed with the journal. There are various types of papers, like full paper, letters, communication, review papers, and so on. You need to decide whether you will go to specific field, multidisciplinary type of journal. And very often for me, for example, the problem is what type of paper I'm going to write. Is this going to be a paper where I am going to provide some kind of new tool? Like, for example, I'm going to present a new algorithm and hope, in the hope that someone will use this algorithm in the future, so I give him a tool. Or am I going to write a paper which is, I call it a storytelling paper. So basically I take the algorithm, I study the properties of the algorithm or properties of the model, and I will tell the story about the behavior of the model. And of course I'm trying to find in this behavior some interesting aspects which are worth of publishing, right? So, yeah, so the selection of journals should be done, in my view, early. There are also tools. I don't know to what extent to recommend these tools, because if the tool is provided by a publisher, then of course it's a sort of biased towards this publisher. But there are many publishers providing tools that will allow you to search through the journals. I listed here a couple of these tools. You should also be prepared for the alternative. Like if you go really high, the likelihood is that you will get rejected. And you should also think about what are the maybe alternative journals you will go for if the first option will not work. This is actually, as far as I know, quite a frequent approach at the top universities, right? The ambition has to be very high. People go for really top journals. They fail very often, and then they go for journal which is lower, right? So don't think that people who publish in these very good journals, that they get everything published in these very good journals, right? Very often they fail, so don't be worried to fail, right? Failure is a part of the process. You should also match the scope of the journal. If you go to the webpage of the journal, every journal is describing what the journal expects that you will do in your paper. So for example, if you look at PRL, what is expected is that you will substantially advance a particular field, you open a new significant area of research, you solve critical outstanding problem or make significant step towards solving such a problem, be of great general interest based, for example, on scientific aesthetics. So you need to know what are the expectations, and when you communicate to the journal, you should be able to communicate and you should be able to explain in what way you are meeting expectations of the journal. Okay, so another part of selection of the journal is maybe to know the review process of the journal. I think you have discussed review process, right? We can skip this slide. Good, we save some time. Maybe I will also reduce this a little bit. This is a couple of recommendations how to look for journals, or how to go for journals you don't know. I also very often I'm trying to submit something to journal, I don't know. My rule of thumb is the following. So I'm trying to absorb what I call the style of the journal by reading and checking papers that are published in the journal, roughly about 20 papers. So if I go for journal which I don't know, I download 20 papers from a given journal, and I'm trying to understand the style. What paper has different parts, right? What is the importance of each given? What is the importance given by a given journal to each part of the paper? How the story should be presented? What type of stories are appearing in this journal, and so on. Let me tell you why I'm doing it, right? Because sometimes I get interested in some kind of problem, and for example, this doesn't fit journals that I already know, right? Mm-hmm. And I need to go to journal that I haven't published in before. So basically, I need to do a lot of homework to study the journal, right? To know the journal before I try. This is what I'm trying to say here. And you should be also aware of this list, Bill's list of predatory journals. So no comment on that, right? We talk about collaboration, selection of the topic, selection of the journal. So let's finally start talking about writing, at least in a very short form. I think you heard a lot about writing. You have seen some kind of general structure that you can follow while you are writing. I would say, many people can have a different opinion, but in my view, this is a good structure to follow. At least if you are starting. One big advantage of this structure is so-called opportunistic reading, which is something you should have in mind when you are writing your paper. So basically, you should have in mind how people are going to read your paper. Right? Most of the people, big circle here, they will just read your title. Then a smaller group of people will read your abstract, and very small group of people will read the whole paper. I would actually add here even one layer. This is something what I learned from physicists, that basically they write papers in a way that, okay, title is the most important, abstract is very important, and next, after the abstract, is your figures and captions. Because what people do, they check the title, oh, interesting. They check the abstract, interesting. Then they check figures and read captions. And while they do it, this already should give them a lot of information about the paper. Right? And if even this will attract them, then they will read the whole story of your paper. How to write the paper? I think the traditional view, at least I would expect, is that you have an idea, then you do the research, so you work out the idea, you check whether the idea is working. If it is working, you write a paper, right? I think this is not probably the best approach, although it's very simple. It can work if you have really very good idea. If it really works, you checked it works, you write it down, you submit, and it's published, right? But you need to be a guy who is getting really very good ideas. I think this is very hard, and it happens very occasionally, right? So in principle, what you have to do, you have to start with some kind of initial idea. And therefore, it's very good to start with writing at the moment when you start with research. So basically, you start with some kind of initial idea. Maybe it's stupid, maybe it's silly, you check that it's not working. But you need to start also writing about it. Why? Writing forces you to be clear, right? To really think about every detail of this idea. It happened to me many times that I thought, oh, this is a brilliant idea. Then I wrote it down and I realized that it's rubbish. Right? It's, only 5 minutes. Okay, good. And writing opens possibilities for sharing with others, right? If you develop the paper in a collaborative way, you need to share your ideas with others. How can you share ideas with someone who is 1,000 kilometers from here if you don't write as you do your research? I don't know. Typically, when you start with your idea, you should improve until you are happy and you believe that this is publishable. And this is maybe another view how to develop a paper, right? So paper is not written in the order of how it's structured. I guess have you discussed this previously? Okay, skip. You should devote enough time to writing. I don't know how much in average it takes you to produce a paper, but if you want to produce a very good paper, it may take you years. And to be honest, this was my first very big surprise when I moved to the group of Professor Helbing, that suddenly I saw people working on the paper, and it took like 1 year, 2 years, and it was not an exception. It really took 2 years to work out the paper. It's very time-consuming process, and it's just my feeling that here we have a tendency to not put enough energy, not to put enough time into scientific papers, and that maybe therefore these papers are not so good. Okay, 5 minutes. Yeah, so maybe just, you should also invest some time into tools that can help you to develop the paper and to produce the style of the paper, right? These are tools which I'm using. Of course, you can find a different set of tools. Then it's very good to have a strategy of a guinea pig, which means that once you have a feeling that it seems that the paper is finished, then you should send it to a couple of people and see what is the feedback. The problem with this actually is that typically when you do that, you receive a paper where the grammar is corrected. And very often this is not what you are interested in, right? You want help in improving the idea of the paper, right? So you need to take some additional effort in the communication with the people who are providing you to this feedback, to really get the feedback that you need. And maybe you need to find the right people. Another important topic is communication with the journal editor. I don't know, was this discussed? Basically, the main thing is to write a cover letter. Cover letter is, for example, not an abstract, it's something else. And what I can give you here is some kind of template, which to me looks like a very good template to follow when you are preparing cover letter for your paper. Okay, so here you find described each of these sections. Typically, these two last sections, they are typically nowadays done in the submission system. If not, you should include it to the cover letter. Okay, this is on the importance of the cover letter. Then after the cover letter comes your fight with the reviewers. In principle, I think my advice is always to take the position that you are accepting the criticism, that you are also grateful for the criticism. If not for anything else, then because these guys, they invested time into your paper, right? And what did they receive for this? Nothing, right? Just they are maybe a couple of hours closer to their death, right? So be grateful for the criticism, and thank to reviewers in their reply, and also work out your reply very carefully, the best way you can. What I like to do, for example, if they send me a list of comments, I write my reply after each comment. And I'm trying to make it very, very clear that in the reply that it's not a lot of work for reviewer to check the changes in the manuscript. Right, so refer to the pages, refer to the paragraphs, or even maybe better, highlight the changes in the manuscript when you are resubmitting your paper. Let's hope that you have convinced your reviewers. Now the last part is a promotion of your paper. You shouldn't also underestimate it. If you have published at least two papers, then I think you should go for this stuff, right? You should have your ResearchGate account, maybe Scholar Google account. You should be sending papers to preprint archives, like Archive, if you work in optimization, maybe Optimization Online, right? To promote your stuff as much as you can. In science, there is no bad promotion, right? You can only promote. In the worst case, people ignore. So you should be working with social media, trying to really get to know to people as much as you can if you manage to publish. If possible, you should even maybe try to arrange a press release if you think it's really worth to do that. Right. Every university, even our university, has a person who is responsible for writing press releases. I did it once. When I contacted them second time with the paper, they were not so interested, so I didn't try a third time. But I personally believe that it would be actually very nice to have some kind of news section on the main webpage of the university. Where the press releases about the most important publications are shown to the public, that we show to people outside of university that we do research. It's not only about promoting and advertising, but it's also good to monitor your articles, to monitor how people read your articles, how people cite your articles. From that you can get some feedback, you can learn what worked and what didn't work. Actually, I have very strange experience. I always have a feeling that papers which I like the most are not really so much quoted, and sometimes papers which I don't like so much, they are quoted. So I must say that I don't understand this process. I still don't understand it. And here is a couple of other recommendations, like become a reviewer, so you should also try to see it from the other side, how it looks like. And dedicate time on various types of trainings. And here is actually the tool which I can recommend you when it comes to grammar and English. It's called Grammarly. I know that it's used by many PhD students, many postdocs, even at very good universities. And it's a sort of, do you know Grammarly? Right? It's a sort of tool that uses machine learning in order to propose you some changes in the text and improvements in the text. And this is just the summary of the main points. I think you need to be really strongly motivated. If you want to make it, you need to be strongly motivated. It's not simple. I highly recommend you to look for collaborations and collaborations opportunities. In my view, it's a good idea to to think about the way how are you going to publish the paper before you start writing the paper. You should start writing the paper very early, at the same moment as you start working on the paper. You shouldn't underestimate the communication. Either it can be communication with the editor, communication with reviewers, maybe communication with the general public, or maybe with the scientific community. And let me tell you that, in my view, this is not about some kind of inborn talent, but it's about acquired skills. So you can learn all of this, right? You maybe can have the idea that all the best ideas can be produced only by the best people. Okay, to some extent, but I would say nowadays it's a little bit different than it used to be 50 years or 100 years ago, right? Most of the research is some kind of collaborative enterprise, and some kind of individual results are becoming less and less frequent. Okay, and here I listed a couple of references. These are basically videos that you can find on the YouTube, given by quite interesting people on more or less this topic. Okay, I'm done.